So the next talk will also be about elementary neuronal networks. But you may understand that we have to build up a structure so that if we would like to reach the stage when we can talk about higher cognitive functions, emotions, moral judgments, music, body ownership, and so on, we need to know a little bit about the basic underpinnings of the human brain and the brain in general. So please forgive us to start the first day with heavy but beautiful lectures. I hope you will understand through these lectures how complicated the human brain is and what are the challenges we have to deal with when we would like to interpret behavior, cognition, emotion, and even aesthetics. So the next speaker has been the PhD student of the former speaker, but he is now head of one of the largest neuroscience research institutes in the world, Tamás Freund. He is a neuroanatomist, educated in Budapest and then in Oxford under Peter Somogyi, and he is now the director of the Institute of Experimental Medicine in Budapest, an institution which is having a large number of neuroscientists. Tamás is also the vice president of the Hungarian Academy of Science, and of course, a very good friend. But I don't want to talk too much about him. Let him talk about his topic.
Thank you very much, Balázs, for the kind introduction and the invitation. I think our talks with Peter should have been the other way around, because what I'm planning to do is to give you a kind of historical overview of 30 years of our work, a serious quest into the mechanisms how theta activity can be brought about. And in this talk, I, of course, will not have time to go into such details as Peter has been going into and revealing to us unpublished magnificent data. So I apologize, but I didn't know what he's going to talk about. Otherwise, we would have swapped. So indeed, we have spent almost 30 years to investigate how theta activity is brought about. Why that is so important, luckily Peter already summarized for you. He also summarized what the hippocampus is all about, so I don't have to waste time with this. So what has been known about the hippocampal theta generation, it's dating back to the early 1960s when Pecce and his laboratory in Vienna, they have discovered that pacemaker neurons of hippocampal theta reside in the medial septum, although later it turned out that they have, although some endogenous pacemaker currents, there are subcortical centers already mentioned by Peter from the brainstem and some feedback inputs via the thalamus that would govern the pacemaker activity or the rhythm dictating activity of the medial septal neurons. So what has been shown by Pecce in the early 60s is that following lesions of the septum diagonal band complex, hippocampal theta disappears. And also when they have been transecting the fimbria fornix, the theta disappeared from the hippocampus, but the neurons of the medial septal complex, they carried on firing at theta frequency. So this was really a puzzling question. How in the rat, a couple of thousand neurons in the medial septum are able to synchronize at theta frequency millions or tens of millions of neurons in the hippocampus? For me, the most interesting result of that time was published by Graham Goddard's group in 1985, where he showed that when stimulating the entorhinal cortex and comparing the evoked PSPs to stimulating the medial septum, they found something really interesting. They were recording from the hilus of the dentate gyrus, so when you stimulate the entorhinal cortex, the perforant path, you have the field EPSP, and then this negative break on this field EPSP reflects the number of granule cells that have been discharged by that particular stimulus of the entorhinal cortex. When they simulated the septum alone, you can see there is no field response whatsoever, but when they combine the stimulation of the septum with that of the perforant path, the same amount of field depolarization brought many, many more granule cells to firing threshold. So if you look at the amplitude of the field DPSP, it did not change. There was no additional excitation produced by the septal stimulation. But even the same amount of excitation managed to bring many more granule cells to firing threshold. So if there is no excess excitation, what else could result in the discharge of many more granule cells? A reduction of inhibition. And that's what they already proposed at that time. The surprising result was that when they added scopolamine, there was no change. And at that time, the medial septal projection to cortical s was considered a purely cholinergic projection. So they have discovered something that produces disinhibition in the hippocampus, which is not cholinergic. So that's when electrophysiologists and pharmacologists have stuck and came the anatomists. The anatomists managed to show in 1984, it was the first paper by Amaral and Kurtz, that not nearly all of the medial septal projection neurons are cholinergic. Not more than about 50% turned out to be cholinergic and positive for the synthetizing enzyme of acetylcholine. This is cholinacetyltransferase. You can see it in blue. This group of cholinergic cells form a V upside down, and down in the diagonal band, they form a ring like a donut. And the other half of the neurons turned out to be mostly GABAergic. Projection GABAergic neurons with distant projection, they cannot be labeled with GAD in their cell body, but luckily we have managed to show that these GABAergic cells in the medial septum, which project to the hippocampus, contain parvalbumin. So parvalbumin turned out to be not only a good marker of GABAergic interneurons in hippocampus, but also a good marker of GABAergic projection neurons in the medial septum. So here we double-labeled the septal sections for cholinacetyltransferase and parvalbumin. The brown is parvalbumin, so you can see parvalbumin-positive GABAergic neurons. They fill the gap between these cholinergic cell groups that form this V upside down. In the diagonal band, the cholinergic neurons form a ring, and within that circle, you have the GABAergic projection neurons. So we were interested in the potential involvement of the GABAergic septohippocampal neurons in producing the disinhibition that could be predicted from this Goddard study. How can you study the termination pattern of this distant GABAergic projection that goes from the septum to the hippocampus? You cannot stain simply for parvalbumin or GABA, the hippocampal sections, because you cannot distinguish the axons of septal origin from the axons of local interneuronal origin. So we had to use a tracing technique. So we injected PAGL, the Fasolus vulgaris leucoagglutinin, which is an anterograde tracer. We injected it into the medial septum, neurons take it up, and then they transport it to the very end of their axons. And all you need to do then is to visualize the PAGL-labeled axons in the hippocampus. So what you see here is a picture from the CA3 region of the hippocampus. All these fibers are PAGL positive, immunostained for this anterograde tracer, so we know that they all come from the medial septum. And already at this cursory glance, you see that they appear to belong to two distinct types. One type of fibers have large boutons, they seem to surround cell bodies in the background. The other type has thinner axons, smaller boutons, and they distribute quasi-randomly in the neuropil. So what we thought, perhaps one type could be the cholinergic, the other type could be the GABAergic component of the septohippocampal projection. How can you test this prediction? Here you can see even better the difference between what we call the type 1 and the type 2 fibers. You can cut these axons for for EM, and EM sections, these ultra-thin sections on grids, can be immunostained using the immunogold procedure for GABA. And that's what we did, and what we found that whenever an axon terminal belonged to a type 1 fiber, it was always positive for GABA. And none of the type 2 fibers were positive, so that appears to prove directly that indeed, that indeed type 1 fibers correspond to the GABAergic component of the septohippocampal projection, and type 2 corresponds to the most likely the cholinergic component. This was somehow expected, but what we did not expect at all was that whenever the presynaptic septal terminal was GABA positive, invariably the postsynaptic element was also positive for GABA. And that turned out to prove a remarkable target selectivity. A projection coming from a distant brain area like 7, 8 millimeters enters the hippocampus, and there it is able to pick out those GABAergic interneurons that represent not more than about 10% of the local neurons. That is a remarkable target specificity. So whenever type 1 fibers were positive for GABA, the postsynaptic element was also, here you can see the corner of a cell body, which would be like this big, and you can see the scattered immunogold, colloidal gold particles that allowed us to identify this cell body as a GABA-positive cell body. Here, the colloidal gold particles show that this terminal with the DAB as an end product that shows that here as allows us to identify this as an axon coming from the septum, and the colloidal gold allows us to identify this as GABA-positive. Here, just to show you the background staining, there is hardly any gold particles whatsoever over axon terminals that are glutamatergic. They contain round vesicles and form asymmetrical synapses. These we know are definitely glutamate positive. They never had any colloidal gold particles, so the staining was really specific. Luckily, you have gone through Peter's slides with all the different interneuron types. And the obvious next question we asked, which of the interneuron types are under septal GABAergic control? Here, let me just call you the attention to the two major classes that Peter already mentioned. Those interneurons that innervate the pyramidal cell body region, mostly the basket cells, but also the chandelier cells, terminating on axon initial segments. And the other major class of interneurons, that their axon avoids the pyramidal cell body layer, but terminates on dendritic segments. This one terminates on the most distal segments of dendrites in stratum lacunosum molecularum, where they coincide with the entorhinal input. And this one, the bistratified cell, also terminates mostly on dendrites, and that input coincides with the Schaffer collateral input. So both of these are controlling the excitator input from distinct sources, whereas this one would rather control the output of principal, large groups of principal cells. So, of course, it was of major functional interest for us, which of these types are under control by septal GABAergic cells. Here you can see a double labeling for PAGL. These brown dendrites belong to parvalbumin-positive interneurons in the dentate gyrus, and the bluish-black axon is a PAGL-labeled medial septal axon crossing stratum molecularum, and as you can see, it is dropping axon terminals exclusively on the parvalbumin-positive dendrites. You cannot see any axon terminals in between, while there are thousands or hundreds of granule cell dendrites, they are not innervated at all. So already this single picture was rather shocking to us because that convinced us about the remarkable target specificity. Now what about markers of other interneurons? We have gone through all the different interneuron markers that were available in those years. Calbindin as a marker of dendritic inhibitory cells. They were also innervated, as you can see here. This brown interneuron cell body is completely surrounded by the GABAergic septal axons. Here, another cell body is contacted. Here, another cell body. Whereas these white cell bodies belong to pyramidal cells, they are completely ignored. And we looked at somatostatin, MPY, VIP, CCK, all the different interneuron types. They were indiscriminately innervated by medial septal GABAergic fibers. I had a good friend from Spain. He visited us in the early 90s from Valencia, Francisco Martinez Guijarro. He deceased, unfortunately, since he was an expert on lizard brain anatomy. And we had the idea, why not look at whether the septohippocampal projection is or has an ancient phylogenetic origin. And we injected with PAGL the basal forebrain of the lizard. And the lizard has already a kind of very primitive hippocampus or cortex-like structure, the medial and the dorsolateral cortex, which appear to correspond to the dentate gyrus versus CA3. And then what we found, whichever interneuron marker we stained for, they were mostly surrounded by GABAergic basal forebrain afferents. And we know that in phylogeny, cortex appeared first in lizards or similar reptiles. So we can conclude that as soon as cortex appeared in phylogeny, it already received a GABAergic projection from the basal forebrain. So that kind of subcortical control of cortical activity or synchronous discharge patterns is as ancient as cortex itself. So all this data I told you so far, we published in Nature in 1988. So they are pretty ancient discoveries. And with this, we thought we managed to prove what is the mechanism by which a numerically sparse input, like the septohippocampal input that arises from only a few thousand neurons, is able to synchronize a region as big as the hippocampus or even the surrounding cortical areas containing tens of millions of neurons. And this mechanism is the selective innervation of local GABAergic interneurons. And each of these local GABAergic interneurons are able to synchronize the activity of local principal cells. One basket cell would innervate like 1,000 to 2,000 neurons. Since many of you are not specialized in hippocampus or in inhibition, let me show you briefly a video, an animation that I got prepared by the Hungarian TV when I gave them a lecture, a televised lecture. No, it is not showing. What happened? This has been working before. I can see it on the screen, but not there. Can somebody help? We tried it, but now it's not showing there. Aha. How did you do that? That's okay. So, Let's consider that you are all swimming here in a big swimming pool, and I am an octopus with the task to synchronize everybody's breathing. So all I need to do is just grab everybody with many of my arms, pull you underwater, and release you together after about 1 or 2 minutes. Now I guarantee that the first breath will be absolutely synchronous for all of you. And if I repeat this rhythmically, then I can synchronize all of the breathing. So that's exactly what we believe the perisomatic inhibitory cells are doing. Principal cells firing away asynchronously, but only until they get a barrage of IPSPs from the basket cell. And then when they are released from inhibition, they will fire very nicely together. But the problem is not solved yet, because each of these basket cells can only innervate 1,000 to 2,000 neurons, but we want to synchronize the entire hippocampus or even the connected brain areas. How can we do that? Just imagine that there are many, many more pools. And in each of the pools, there is one octopus which is synchronizing the breathing of all the people in that particular pool. Now, how can we introduce synchrony among the pools? For that, we need a super octopus. And this super octopus is standing above all the pools, is extending an arm into every single pool where he's not interested at all in people. It is sufficient to synchronize the activity of the octopuses in each of the pools. And that's exactly what is happening in the septohippocampal system, where local GABAergic neurons are able to synchronize, the basket cells are able to synchronize their thousands and thousands of pyramidal cells, and the activity of these basket cells and other types of interneuron cells we will see later are rhythmically synchronized by the septohippocampal GABAergic pacemaker neurons. So, I hope I can go back now. Can I go back to this? Yeah. Ah, good. So, maybe whatever I told you before was quite believable, because anatomy can be really suggestive, but yet all the conclusions I made so far were based on indirect lines of evidence. How can we provide direct evidence that GABAergic septal neurons would disinhibit large groups of principal cells in the hippocampus? For that, you need electrophysiology, and the most obvious experiment would have been to record from the hippocampus and to stimulate the medial septal pacemaker units. But there is a problem. First of all, there are several other subcortical pathways that arise from the brainstem, like or midbrain, like serotonin, they noradrenaline, they go forward in the medial forebrain bundle and then curve back at the level of the septum to innervate the hippocampus. So with a septal-stimulating electrode, you will activate all these. In addition, we know that there are pyramidal cells in the hippocampus which project to the lateral septum. And then with the septal-stimulating electrode, you will backfire these pyramidal cells, and all their local collaterals are going to release a lot of glutamate. So in vivo, it is just impossible to solve this problem with electrical stimulation. Now, these days, the situation would be, of course, different with optogenetics and optic stimulation. So what, if not in vivo, how can we do that in vitro? In vitro has the advantage of being able to use all kinds of antagonists to block the unwanted glutamate effects, unwanted cholinergic, noradrenergic, serotonergic effects. For that, you have to cut a slice. You have to cut a slice that contains both the hippocampus and the septum and the interconnecting pathway, which is about 6 millimeters. And that appeared to be a very, very difficult task. Here you can see a horizontal section through the rat brain, and the medial septum and the hippocampus are here, and the interconnecting pathway forms an S shape. So it curves at two different places, at two different planes. So there was no simple way of cutting a slice that would have both of these regions without cutting through the interconnecting pathway. So we thought that if the pathway is curved, why don't we straighten it up? So we have cut out a corner from the red brain, as you can see along this broken line. And along this broken line, we have straightened up the brain and stuck the brain in this way to the vibrotome chunk and then made the slices for electrophysiology. And if you do that, then this is what you see. Medial septum, fimbria fornix, and CA3, CA1. Everything very nicely there, what you need. And this we confirmed with anatomy. This is the very same slice stained for cholinacetyl transferase. Here you have the cholinergic cell group. Stained for parvalbumin, here you have the GABAergic cell group, all in the medial septum, and the pathway can be followed to the hippocampus. Higher power individual GABA fibers can be followed to the hippocampus, where you have all these parvalbumin-positive interneurons as well. So all we need to do now is to put an electrode into pyramidal cells or interneurons in the hippocampal part of the slice, and then stimulate the medial septum. And of course, in the presence of all the antagonists of those transmitters that we don't want to stimulate. So this is what you can record in the presence of these glutamate antagonists from pyramidal cells. These spontaneous PSPs are IPSPs, GABAergic IPSPs, that derive from local interneurons. In these slices, the interneurons are spontaneously active, and their activity, of course, is going to produce IPSPs, in the pyramidal cells. When we stimulate the medial septum, the spontaneous iPSPs disappear. So this was already evidence, the very first evidence, that indeed the septohippocampal GABAergic projection is able to silence GABAergic interneurons in the hippocampus, thereby disinhibit pyramidal cells. These vertical lines are only the stimulation artifacts. So indeed, during the stimulation, these iPSPs disappear. Now, when we were simultaneously recording from an inhibitory cell and the pyramidal cell in the hippocampus, and then tried stimulating the septum, we managed to confirm the amazing specificity, what we already showed with anatomy, that septal stimulation produced an iPSP only in the inhibitory cell, but never in the pyramidal cells. In the pyramidal cells, you only saw a slight depolarization, and this slight depolarization was the result of removing these spontaneous iPSPs. Just to confirm that our pyramidal cells are in a good shape and can be inhibited, we stimulated local hippocampal GABAergic fibers, and they managed to evoke readily the iPSPs, both in pyramidal cells and the inhibitory interneurons. Here you can see a spontaneously active interneuron, and when you stimulated the medial septum, it stopped firing. In addition, we managed to produce theta pattern stimulation. I just lost that slide. Theta pattern stimulation, which resulted in a synchronous oscillation of the membrane potential of two distinct pyramidal cells in the hippocampal part of the slice. So indeed, by doing rhythmic inhibition of the inhibitory cells, which is rhythmic disinhibition of principal cells, we were able to produce synchronous membrane potential oscillations in pyramidal cells in the hippocampal part of the slice. So we consider this as direct evidence, although in vitro, that there is septohippocampal disinhibition that is able to produce theta activity in the hippocampus. This goes very nicely hand in hand with Yuri Buzhaki's group's finding, which they published in 1995 in hippocampus. Here is an extracellular field recording showing nice hippocampal theta waves, and the gamma, fast gamma, is riding on top of the of the theta waves. And then in an adjacent location, they were able to record an interneuron, which later the post hoc identified as a basket cell, because this was intracellular recorded and filled. So what you can see is that basket cell is producing packages of action potentials, four or five action potentials in one package. And each of these packages are perfectly aligned with the negative peak of local CA1 pyramidal theta. Now, this is not surprising if we know that the activity of these basket cells is which is resulting in the hyperpolarization, rhythmic hyperpolarization of nearby pyramids, and that is, of course, resulting in the oscillation you can see with an extracellular electrode. Now, what has been shown by Peter already, and what they have reviewed in Science in 2008, is that the various different types of inhibitory cells have distinct phase relationships to hippocampal theta. As he very nicely summarized for you before, pyramidal cells, they fire, of course, when they are closest to firing threshold, which is at the peak of intracellular theta, which is the trough of extracellular theta. Basket cells, both C6 and parvalbumin containing and the other perisomatic inhibitory cell, fires out of phase with pyramidal cells. That is again predictable, since these are the cells that hyperpolarize pyramids in this phase. But what was surprising at that time, and I think it surprised Peter as well as anyone who has worked on this system, was that the ORM cells and the bistratified cells, they fired out of phase with the other interneurons, and they fired in phase with the pyramidal cells. Now, how can you reconcile this with the fact that all of these interneuron types get an input from GABAergic septohippocampal pacemakers? So then Peter already told the basic message of this study, which we had at that time. We were recording from individual medial septal units with the juxtacellular recording method, and we're recording hippocampal EEG from the dorsal hippocampal CE1 region and correlated the firing of these septal units. And here you can see that they indeed fire very nicely phase log, in this case to the negative peak of the trough of theta. They were post hoc identified that they contain parvalbumin. And in addition, we also revealed their local axon collaterals, and these local axon collaterals have been cut for EM. We were unable to precisely identify their local targets in the medial septum, but all the subcellular data pointed to the conclusion that they must be other pacemaker neurons. So there is definitely a collateral interaction between various septohippocampal projection neurons. And again, the major conclusion we had at this point was that there is a bimodal distribution of the phase relationship. One population of the pacemakers fire at the trough, the other near the peak of hippocampal CE1 theta. This gave rise to the hypothesis which we put forward at that time. And that hypothesis is that the so-called peak cells, the peak cells, I mean the pacemaker cells in the medial septum that are active during the peak of extracellular theta, they would inhibit the OLM cells and thereby disinhibit the most distal dendrites of pyramidal cells. In the same time, those pacemakers that innervate the basket cell are inactive, either inactive for some unknown reason or because they are inhibited by local collaterals of the peak cells. So in any case, this scenario explains very nicely what you see on a current source density plot. There is an active sink in lacunosum molecularis which reflects an excitation coming from the entorhinal cortex. This is allowed because inhibition to the very same layer is blocked. On the other hand, basket cells produce an active source, an outward, an inward chloride current in stratum pyramidale. Now what happens during the trough phase of extracellular theta? In the trough phase, pyramidal cells fire. They can do that because, or at least they have the highest probability of firing. They can do that because basket cells are inhibited by the so-called trough pacemakers. These trough pacemakers would then inhibit also those pacemakers that would innervate the OLM cells. So in this case, OLM cells are active and produce an active source in lacunosum molecularis, preventing any efficacy or excitation to excite CA1 pyramidal cells in stratum lacunosum molecularis. So they appear to block plasticity of the incoming perforant path input. So now Peter has gone much further in this. They have been beautifully identifying the individual septohippocampal neurons and their target specificity, and they provided very nice direct evidence for some of the conclusions or some of the hypotheses which we have put forward. This hypothetical circuit, which is now getting more and more supported by data, can explain or answer three questions. How can septal pacemakers induce out-of-phase firing of basket and OLM cells? Why is there a 180-degree phase shift between pyramidale and lacunosum molecularis theta? And why do we have two types, or at least two types, of medial septal pacemakers firing out-of-phase? Of course, if you look at Peter's data, there is a smear of phase relationship with hippocampal theta, but I'm pretty sure that it's due to the fact that there is a phase shift of theta in the hippocampus when you move from the septal to the temporal pole. And if we were able somehow to separate, maybe with antidromic stimulation, to separate the units in the septum that project to the septal pole or the temporal or the ventral pole, and then look at phase relationships of those with theta phases in those particular slabs of the hippocampus, we would have a much, much more precise distribution of phase relationships. So this, however, raises another problem, because rhythmic activity of the septal cells is generated mostly by endogenous pacemaker currents, but of course these are very massively modulated by brainstem inputs. And if individual pacemakers generate their pacemaker rhythm independent from each other, then there has to be a mechanism that synchronizes them. Otherwise, they would dictate a totally confusing rhythmicity to the hippocampus. So what is the mechanism that synchronizes the septal pacemaker cells? And maybe not into one, but into two groups, to the peak cells and to the trough cells, which fire almost completely antiphase. What we thought one possible mechanism could be the recurrent collateral interaction between the medial septal units. And then again, this has not yet been shown, but we would very much like to demonstrate that there are recurrent collateral interactions in a way that would also explain the antiphase activity of the peak versus the trough cells. Another way of synchronizing the individual pacemakers is a feedback from the hippocampus. And now I would like to spend a few minutes with that. It was already Christer Köhler who showed in 1984 that there are stratum oriens neurons in the hippocampus that project back, project to the medial septum. And we have shown it directly with retrograde transport and combined it with GABAergic markers. Here you can see call binding containing GABAergic cells in the oriens alveolus, retrogradely labeled. So what we aim to do, to look at their targets in the medial septum, again, using the PAGL anterograde tracing. Here is a PAGL injection into pyramidal and oriens. Of course, you cannot deliver a bulk injection without injecting also pyramidal cells, but we know that pyramids only terminate in the lateral septum. And the medial septum and the diagonal band is innervated only by the GABAergic cells. This we have shown also with post-embedding immunogold labeling. All these fibers terminating in the medial septum diagonal band turned out to be positive for GABA. Now, which types of septal neurons would be innervated by the hippocampal feedback? Here you can see double labeling for PAGL and cholinacetyltransferase. CAT is in brown, and PAGL fibers are in blue. This is the midline of the septum, and as you can see, the fibers coming from the hippocampus terminate medial from the group of cholinergic cells. What do we have medial from the group of cholinergic cells? You have the paravalbumin cells. In the diagonal band, where the cholinergic cells form this donut, this ring, the hippocamposeptal fibers terminate in the inside of the ring, but they seem to avoid completely the cholinergic cells. And what do we have inside this cholinergic ring? We have the GABAergic cells. So there appears to be not a complete specificity, but a very high preference of the hippocamposeptal feedback to the GABAergic, mostly septohippocampal neurons, or septocortical neurons. So this is the scheme. These hippocamposeptal neurons, they are distributed in stratum oriens, and we showed they get a massive convergent input from pyramidal cell local collaterals. So their activity likely reflects the population activity of local principal cells. And when they get activated, they send their axon back into the medial septum, where they innervate mostly the GABAergic septohippocampal neurons, and only occasionally the cholinergic component. Then we were interested in the activity or the functional consequences of activating the hippocamposeptal neurons. And this is more recent work in preparation. Victor Varga is leading the in vivo laboratory of our department, and with two talented postdocs, they have been doing optogenetic experiments to investigate the physiological effect of hippocamposeptal feedback. Here you can see, we know that the hippocamposeptal neurons contain somatostatin. So we have been delivering channel rhodopsin containing and switch R containing viruses in a Cray dependent manner into somatostatin Cray mice. So when you inject the virus into stratum oriens, then you can avoid labeling the pyramidal cells completely. You only label the OLM cells, which innervate the most distal dendrites of pyramids, and the hippocampal septal neurons. So we were then using optical stimulation with an optic fiber placed within the medial septum. So we were not stimulating axons of the somatostatin-containing local interneurons in the hippocampus, but only the axons that were going from the hippocampus to the medial septum, the classical hippocampal-septal neurons. So what you can see, this is unit activity, this is local field potential in hippocampus. What you can see is that stimulating the channel rhodopsin-containing fibers coming from hippocampal-septal neurons, they can silence septal units. However, this happened only when the animal was more or less in rest. When the animal was moving, this shows movement on a linear track, stimulating the septal fibers was ineffective at all. Again, in the same linear track, when the animal was standing still, the septal stimulation was again effective. Here you can see just the onset of movement right here, and it was effective here, but as soon as the animal started to move, the stimulation became ineffective again. Here we interpreted this as as a fact that hippocampal septal cells are likely to be already maximally active when the animal is moving. So if I stimulate it further with an optogenetic method, it cannot produce any further inhibition. And in spite of this enhanced inhibition, these cells can fire because they are already driven in such a way that they can override this inhibition. And this inhibition probably there to synchronize rather than to block firing. Yes, this is just to show the other way. Switch R is a modified channel rhodopsin which opens a chloride channel. So this should inhibit transmitter release if activated in axons. And this is indeed what you see at rest when you stimulate when you activate switch R, which means you inhibit the hippocampal septal fibers, these septal units start to fire like hell. This is at rest, and this is while the animal was moving. And that turned out to be true for non-rhythmic cells as well as for rhythmic cells. Andor Domonkos, a very talented postdoc, he went to Attila Losonczy's lab in Colombia, where Attila was routinely using a belt running paradigm, and they were able to record the activity of neurons with the GCAMP6, this genetically encoded calcium indicator that was delivered by a rabies virus. And rabies virus is known to go through one synapse only in a retrograde fashion. So when they injected this rabies virus into the medial septum, medial septal neurons took it up, and then the virus was transported retrogradely into the axons of the hippocampal septal fibers and got transported back to the cell body where they were expressing the GCAMP6. So they could do two-photon imaging in the freely moving animal running on a belt and then correlate the hippocampal septal neuronal firing to theta activity and to movement. And what you can see here, the red lines show movement. And as soon as the animal moved, these cells, the hippocampal septal cells, started to fire like mad. Even if there was just a very, very brief movement, the hippocampal septal system already got activated. And they did an even more complicated experiment when they injected a modified rabies virus to deliver the GCAMP6. It was modified in a way that they have cut out the capsid, the envelope of the virus. So without the envelope, the virus cannot assemble itself for retrograde transport. But they have delivered the envelope of the virus via AAV, in an animal which had Cre dependent AAV, that the Cre was in parvalbumin cells. It means that the rabies virus that is able to go through retrogradely through the synapse was assembled only in the parvalbumin containing medial septal neurons. So then they were doing exactly the same kind of GCAM imaging, and the results were confirmed. This is cell, three different cells. As soon as the animal started to move, those hippocampal septal neurons that were innervating the septo-hippocampal parvalbumin cells, they got massively activated. So how could this system operate? What do we believe as the sequence of events might be that leads to ongoing theta? There has to be an enhancement in cholinergic tone, because that increases excitability in the hippocampus and it aborts the hippocampal sharp waves, as shown by Gyuri Buzsáky's group. Septal pacemakers, which are active, some of them even before theta activity would start, they could induce focal synchronization in these hotspots, as Peter's data very nicely show. These septohippocampal pacemakers, they terminate in focal hotspots in the hippocampus. So they can disinhibit local groups of pyramidal cells, and maybe these couple of pacemakers are not in phase with each other, but it doesn't matter if they can disinhibit small groups of pyramids. And if these small groups of pyramids, they are active enough to stimulate the hippocampus septal neurons, and after some time they definitely will be firing in large enough numbers to activate the hippocampus septal feedback, then this will synchronize and phase lock the pacemaker cells. So it might be enough for the system to run just a couple of theta cycles to recruit enough of the hippocampus septal feedback neurons to align in phase the septo-hippocampal cells, and then you get theta activity throughout the hippocampus. So one last hypothetical message is the out-of-phase activity of the basket and OLM cells predicts the role of these interneurons as well as the possible function of theta oscillation. That should be a question mark here. There has been a very nice hypothesis put forward by Mike Hasselmoe and Matt Wilson already some years ago. They claim that one phase of hippocampal theta could be associated with encoding. This is the peak of extracellular theta, and the trough of extracellular theta would correspond to retrieval. And why I like this so much, this hypothesis, is because it perfectly fits this diagram. Because what you want to do during retrieval is that the encoding of sensory information should not disturb your retrieval. So when you retrieve information, pyramidal cells should be firing, and they definitely do fire because basket cells are inhibited by these pacemakers. However, OLM cells are not inhibited, so therefore they massively inhibit the efficacy and plasticity of the incoming entorhinal input. And then in the encoding phase, you of course want to disinhibit the termination zone of the perforant path and inhibit the basket cells, inhibit the soma by the basket cells. So this encoding and retrieval would very nicely fit with the current source density pattern that is explained by this wiring which we have put forward. The function of the OLM cells turns out to be extremely interesting in this setting. We know that OLM cells and their colleagues in the dentate gyrus, the so-called hip cells, they are both driven exclusively in a feedback fashion. We have provided anatomical evidence, and Chris McBain and Maka Faraday provided electrophysiological evidence that these cells can only be discharged in a feedback manner. In the dentate gyrus, it is easier to imagine because excitation comes to the dentate gyrus through the perforant path in the molecular layer, and yet the hip cells never have a dendrite in the molecular layer, only in the hyrus. And in the hyrus, They are activated by local collaterals of these granule cells. So they are exclusively feedback driven, and yet they innervate the perforant path termination zone. Here they are activated by local CA1 collaterals and innervate the perforant path termination zone. So what can be predicted about the activity of these OLM cells? They fire together with the pyramidal cells at the peak of intracellular theta. Pyramids, of course, because that's when they are closest to firing threshold, and OLM cells also, quite obviously, because most of their input comes from the local pyramids. So they obviously have to fire together with the pyramids in the same phase of intracellular theta. And in this phase, in the so-called retrieval phase, they can block interference of sensory encoding with the retrieval. Now, what happens in the peak phase? In peak phase, I mean the trough phase of intracellular theta, peak is extracellular theta. Here, pyramidal cells are massively hyperpolarized, inhibited by the ensemble activity of basket cells. Now, in this phase, in the phase precession mode, only those pyramids can fire which carry specific information, which get massive excess excitation that allows them to override a greater degree of basket cell-mediated inhibition. But these cells, in any place, are very, very sparse. And these very sparse numbers of pyramids are unable to recruit OLM cells. They are going to be unable to produce feedback inhibition in the most distal dendrites. So when their firing coincides with incoming entorhinal inputs, then these inputs can be potentiated, which means encoding will be allowed. The beauty of this has been confirmed by a very nice study of Attila Loschonczy's group that was published in Science, just to provide additional example of the amazing efficacy and specificity of OLM cell function. They have shown that a cholinergic, a massive cholinergic activation of the very same OLM cells by aversive stimuli can prevent the potentiation of those entorhinal inputs that carry specific sensory information about the particular space where the aversive stimulus has been delivered. So this is something really remarkable, emphasizing that these inhibitory interneuron types with very specific subcortical inputs can subserve functions with such a specificity that could not have been imagined before. So it is very difficult to acknowledge all the collaborators that we have been working together with during 30 years. So let me just emphasize those who have been with me for the longest periods: Attila Gulyás, Borhegyi, Acsádi, Katona, Nyíri. In vitro electrophysiology, Richard Miles, Katalin Tóth, Gulyás, Hájos. In vivo electrophysiology, we began it in collaboration with Gyuri, and all members of my lab who are doing in vivo electrophysiology, they learned it mostly in Gyuri's lab. These include Viktor, Balázs, Hangya. And then another set of in vivo electrophysiological experiment using the optogenetic tools. Here I should acknowledge Karl Dyserot and Attila Loschonczy. And with this picture, let me thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Tamás, for the revealing talk about one of the fundamental issues. You may know the hippocampus is part of the cortex, but without understanding the hippocampus, which is not six-layer structure of the cortex, but three-layered, we will not be able to understand the cortex, and we will not be able to understand all the higher functions, which we soon will talk about in the coming talks. So, questions, Wolf.
Thank you, Tamás. Your last remark on the cholinergic veto of a learning process, this was surprising to me, because in neocortex, in many other contexts, it's also fear conditioning. It is the now print juice, inhibiting inhibitory interneurons, allowing LTP to occur. So how does that?
I can only tell you what Attila Loschonczy is claiming, and what he's claiming is that by preventing the conditioning stimulus to consolidate any memory traces during the aversive stimulus allows this to take another, the aversive stimulus to take another route via the amygdala. And then this amygdala circuit would bring in the fear conditioning component. That's how he explained it, but I'm not sure whether I am convinced. At the moment, I cannot come up with any better explanation. It is really surprising why this hippocampal interneuron mediated mechanism would want to block the burning in of that particular sensory environment that would signal you the fear stimulus.
So, Yuri.
So the question is both for Peter and you. The theta oscillation travels, that is, there is a difference about 180 degrees between the dorsal and the ventral hippocampus. But the phase shift also occurs between the CA3 and the CA1 region. So if you imagine either a cube or just a roll, where there are millions of neurons, and each of them are in different phase. So there is an n-dimensional distribution of phases. The phase is different everywhere, but one thing is the same, which is the frequency. When the animal runs faster or slower, or when the animal is under anesthesia or REM sleep, the frequency changes, but the phase shifts are pretty much the same. So now the interesting question is, of course, is that how is it possible to have two separate populations of septal neurons that I understood was also present in Peter's talk, to represent this shifting of these things. It's like, you know, we are traveling all around the world, and then our clock time is always synced to the local time. But somehow, if there would be a coordination of our sleep patterns from a central clock, then all these connections would be done, or would be released. So the question is, where does this coordination comes from? Is it the medial septum? Or is it the hippocampus? And the hippocampal septal cells that you discovered play a major role in this. The other one is a more interesting question, perhaps, is that why do we need the medial septal at all? Why don't we just, nature placed all these GABAergic neurons into the hippocampus? And then this would be perhaps a little bit better dissolved. Why is the need of placing a set of GABAergic neurons together with the cholinergic neurons in a different structure?
I think you more or less answered your question. The traveling wave would probably be explained by a gradual shifting of the phase that is dictated by the pacemaker cells. The pacemaker cells are not firing in precisely one phase, as has been shown by us and also by Peter. There is definitely quite a big scatter. And maybe there would be even bigger scatter if we would not look at only the those that are phase coupled to dorsal hippocampal CA1. So all I can speculate, this is all pure speculation, is that probably there is a kind of regulation that involves also the hippocampal-septal feedback. The hippocampal-septal feedback should send back some information about the local phase in that particular slab of the hippocampus as you move from rostral to ventral direction. Nobody has looked at whether there is any phase specificity of the hippocampal-septal feedback, or at least I don't know. But that would be, I think, a plausible explanation that the phase relationship of the septal pacemaker units would be taught by the hippocampal-septal feedback, and that would be dependent on the phase of the local pyramidal cell activity in that particular slab of the hippocampus. But this is pure speculation. Peter, do you have any better idea?
Yeah, first I would like to correct Yuri. So I showed a sharply tuned population of 5 orchid cells, none of which projected to the hippocampus. So there are all extra hippocampal theta peak tuned neurons, so our knowledge is modest yet to how in the hippocampus this is organized by phase. And although you and Siapas and Lubanov showed that there is what you actually demonstrated, 180 degrees shift, we don't know how continuous that shift is. So that, I think, with the technology that you and they used, first of all, a very small area, then they extrapolated to the rest of the hippocampus, and from your recordings, we don't know how continuous. So it is possible that there are chunks of septotemporal hippocampus. You are thinking of shaking his head because he is thinking of the CA3 cell long projection within the hippocampus. There are chunks which deal with different aspects of memory processes. And the good evidence for this is the different extrahippocampal targets of the pyramidal cells within different parts of the hippocampus. And it's not a continuum. It's quite good boundaries of where the output from the hippocampus goes, both into hypothalamus, septum, and prefrontal cortex, accumbens, etc. So there may be chunks of hippocampus with different phase shifts and with dealing with different aspect of mnemonic processes, different memories. And the septum would relate to this by innervating consecutive regions, and maybe we will discover this with enough cells. So the only little progress I presented is that it's not diffuse, it focuses on one or another aspect of the hippocampus, the few axons that we have. And I wouldn't be surprised if it turns out that they have the phase shift. But what you didn't mention is what would be the significance if the phase shift and the pyramidal cell firing, which you are much better qualified to tell us, is indeed 180 degree shift according to the overall currencies and sources. The consequence of that, that Siapas and Lubanov speculated, is that within one theta cycle time, at any one time, any one moment, or a gamma cycle, say 20 milliseconds, within that, the past, present, and future would be represented, rather than what we used to think of as a sequence within one theta cycle. So that would be a very, very different representation of the memories if it was true. I think you know what I mean, most people wonder. Yeah, so the phase shift is very great cognitive significance. And I think the hypothesis that tiled septal GABAergic input sets it up is a very efficient way. Why the cortex didn't include a neuron like this that would go along?
Well, just to respond to that, it's an interesting thing that here you have a septum that you play that has a very important role in this level, but every single population pattern that I'm aware of in the cortex, like the slow oscillations, like sleep stimulus, they are all traveling. So the traveling phenomena is real. It's independent of the septum.
It's a hypothesis.
Maybe independent of the septum, but it has to go along with the septum. So that's why the feedback is very important.
So, next question.
And just Yuri's second question I didn't answer. I cannot answer, but I can speculate why this GABAergic pacemaker cell had to be placed in the medial septum rather than straight into the hippocampus. My suggestion is that there are all these amazingly selective subcortical, not subcortical, brainstem inputs, reticular formation inputs, whatever. For those, it would be a really great challenge to go into the hippocampus and there find these master pacemaker cells. For them, it is much, much easier just to travel forward in the medial forebrain bundle where they have a nucleus and where they can only, where they have to distinguish between only like 2, 3, 4 cell types. And then that's a kind of hub. The medial septal pacemakers are a kind of hub for several of these reticular formation or brainstem or midbrain, whatever inputs. That hub formation would be impossible if you hide these GABA cells within the very complex network of the hippocampus.
Okay, let's give the floor to the next question.
Sorry, just a layman's question here, because I've noticed that the neuroscientists are asking the questions, and I'm not sure if I even understand the questions, let alone the answers. But did I understand you to say earlier that the hippocampus blocks fear signals? You were, is that right, or is that just a point of clarification?
No, the hippocampus is involved in fear memory formation, in contextual fear, and the hippocampus is supposed to provide the context for the fear memory. And what was really surprising in this study, which I just mentioned, it is not ours, it is Attila Loshonsis from Colombia, is that this specific interneuron type, the OLM cell, appears to block the perforant path input to the pyramidal cells exactly in that moment when the conditioning stimulus should burn in its spatial information into the network to remind the hippocampus now that I should avoid this kind of context.
So I'm just wondering if McLean's triune theory would explain that. I know it's not really scientific theory of the brain, but it was a neuroscientist in the 1950s. It's the only neuroscience I ever came across was when I was in the military, and that was how it was explained to us when we became frightened. The linkage between the reptilian limbic and cortex. Has there been any research on that since the 1950s, or is it still just a theory?
I did not understand the first half of your sentence.
Oh, gosh, that's great. McLean was a neuroscientist in the 1950s, came up with a theory of the three brains, or triune theory. He's still alive. All right. So the reptilian, the limbic, and the cortex. Yeah. Uh-huh. And the reason why the cortex freezes out is that when you're facing a dinosaur, you don't really want to get a flip chart and have a discussion about how you should handle it. You should either fight, flight, or freeze. Mm-hmm. I'm just wondering if that research has continued or is it long gone?
I don't know. I don't think that is a fashionable idea these days, but definitely there are those subcortical projections to cortex that are already existent in the reptilian brain that have an incredible, massive, profound effect on cortical functions, which is quite surprising why the cortex is under such a massive influence of phylogenetically ancient centers. And that probably cannot be imagined without a cortical feedback to these centers. Otherwise, we would still behave like a crocodile. So probably cortex, while developing, is not only exposed to subcortical influences, but it found a way for feedback.
So before we go further, may I just give a short reply to your question, and then Maura, maybe the last question. I happened to spend a week last week in Johannesburg at the University of Witwatersrand, where my good old friend Paul Munger is the professor of comparative neuroanatomy, and he investigated more than 50 different animal species brains, including hippopotamus, whales, dolphins, elephants, antelopes, of course, all these different local animals. And he is actually very much interested in Paul McLean's theory, but not in the classical triunite brain concept, but how the reptilian brain is still present with regard to the connections, as you mentioned, in our system, and how certain mechanisms can be sort of fossilized during evolution, which are present. So I don't believe in the triunite hypothesis of Paul McLean, but the concept is very interesting. What are the conserved neuroanatomical and functional mechanisms, which
it would be interesting to look at whether in the lizard, there is definitely the same kind of septohippocampal projection, massive influence on cortical function. But whether there is a feedback, like in the hippocampus, we have demonstrated there is a hippocampus-septal feedback. So there is, the cortex appears to gain control over this otherwise wide machinery that would drive us just for doing everything for survival and breeding and feeding. So this hippocampus-septal feedback, that's a good idea. It's, this kind of interpretation didn't even occur to my mind before. So
go to Paul Bunger, you will see two huge freezing rooms, huge, containing more than 50 different species in buckets, several brains of these hippopotamus, elephant, and so on. Ask elephant brains, and then...
They probably can't do tracing studies to reveal whether there is a feedback from cortex.
Mara, last question.
Yeah, thank you very much for a very interesting talk. I was wondering, what would be the impact of the loss of cholinergic cells, for example, in Alzheimer's disease, in which I remember that in some transgenic models it has been shown that there is a phase decoupling between theta and gamma oscillations. So
what Yuri Buzsáky nicely showed is that you need a cholinergic septohippocampal activity to work as a kind of permissive input to increase the excitability and to stop the generation of sharp waves, and then prepare the circuit to produce theta oscillation and gamma oscillation. That might be one function. The other one is what we still don't really know the precise importance of, is that this specific conditioning stimulus induced blockade of perforant path input plasticity.
Mm-hmm. So what would be the impact on the OLM cells?
Yeah, the impact of the OLM cells, that's what I tried to show here, is that they fire together with the pyramidal cells at the positive peak of intracellular theta. And if you consider that pyramidal cells probably carry, their firing probably carry specific information, is not during this phase, but when they fire in phase precession mode. So in this phase, you could even consider them as doing some kind of background or noise firing, and theta synchronizes this background firing into one particular phase of theta and ensures that in this phase there will be no plasticity. Because if sufficient numbers of pyramidal cells fire, they can recruit feedback inhibition that terminates in the same layer as the perforant path input. So it doesn't matter that these cells fire and their firing coincides with perforant path input. This cannot be potentiated because it is vetoed by the inhibitory cell. This is not the case when the cells fire in phase precession mode, and in this phase we know definitely their firing carries some specific information. And then they are in any place, they are numerically very, very sparse, and are unlikely to activate the OLM cells, are unlikely to produce feedback inhibition in the distal dendrites. So in this phase, pyramidal cells can potentiate their entorhinal input. We even speculated some time ago that this could be the basis of the mechanism of the formation of the dynamic place fields. Because when you put the animal in a new environment, there are no place fields, but after 20 minutes of exploration, continuous theta, the animal builds up the place fields for most of the pyramids. So one possible mechanism is that when the animal is walking around without any place fields, arrives to a corner, and just for some unknown reason, just because of some local background changes in chloride concentration, extracellular environment, it fires a couple of pyramids, fire a little bit earlier than the others. That will already be enough to escape feedback inhibition, and then those entorhinal synapses that fired in that corner will be potentiated on that cell. So when the animal moves back again to the same corner, this cell will fire again earlier than the others, but this is not by chance anymore. This is because those entorhinal synapses already potentiated on that cell. So the more the animal visits those particular places, then the by chance initiated development of one cell into coding a certain place will be more and more strengthened.
Sorry for stopping the discussion, because in the interest of time, we have to start our coffee break. First of all, I would like to thank Tamás for this excellent talk.